medium small and micro industries. Secondly, what must be done to encourage regulated participation in micro, small and medium enterprises. Third, challenges and issues in finalizing MSSR and how to address them. Fourth, to have a proper entrepreneurship development to support MSSR. And finally, how to shape the outcomes in the overall project. What would make one less capable of execution of this project? We have had two speech speakers, the Zagor Iqbal from the World Bank. And secondly, we have Omar Asafa Sazan, the IOM Deputy Secretary General. And then we have three people with us. Mr. Basil Zanfal, Microfinance Advisor at ICD. Third is the secretary, Mr. Ayala Yassani, the General Chief of International Islamic International General Bank. And finally, Mr. Ayman Nasir Jimmy, Chief Executive Officer of Bank of Central. So as we talk, we will have the speakers, they will be presenting, they will be presenting their comment and presentation. I would like to call upon the first, Mr. Zakir Iqbal, and you will be doing the first
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you, Dr. Azmi, for your kind introduction. It's my pleasure to be here. It's indeed an honor for me to be part of this very important event, and I am thankful to IOFI for giving me chance and invitation to be here. In this particular session, at least, what I'm going to focus on how we could leverage Islamic finance for not only micro but also for SMEs, because some of the issues which we have are pretty much same. I was just going to have a clicker. Thank you. So, what I would like to do is, first of all, just to bring and I kind of give you some background that why it is important for micro and SME institutions and how it links with economic development, because that is very important to understand. More and more research is showing that there is a very close relationship with the contribution of micro and SME institutions and the economic development. Then I will just give you a very short some statistics on what are the issues in OIC countries, which means in the Islamic countries, followed by why we think Islamic finance has a better fit for SMEs, and then some issues of challenges and recommendations. I hope to do this thing in a short period of time, but we can leave this more on discussion. This, you can see this chart on the screen. You'll be again surprised, as I was surprised when I first time saw this thing, that 73% of the world's adult population do not have any interaction with the formal financial sector, which means that they do not have any bank account, they don't have any way of interacting with the bank, they cannot do even borrow money from the from any financial institution. Imagine that 73% of adults, which are almost about 2 billion people. Now, if we this chart shows you that breakdown of those 73%, and you will see that many of these countries are Muslim countries. For example, starting with Pakistan, Pakistan makes about 5.2% of their 73%. Bangladesh, Indonesia, and Egypt, these are the couple of these Muslim countries where we have a very severe issues with the access to finance. Why access to finance is important? As you know, we as a World Bank, we have two goals to achieve. The first goal is to eliminate extreme poverty. And in back in 19 at the turn of the millennium, the goal was to halve the extreme poverty by 2015. And I'm very happy to report to you that overall at the world level, alhamdulillah, we were able to achieve that goal. Now our next goal is by 2030, we want to eliminate extreme poverty, which means that make it below 3%. Our second goal is that to what we call enhanced shared prosperity. Although we have seen that many countries do experience high growth and they do experience economic development, but it's not necessary that that development trickles down to the poor people. So therefore, the main emphasis is that how could we make sure that the growth is equally accessible or to distribute it to the poor segment as well. So I think these are the main kind of issues which the development community is facing, and with that we as the World Bank and other multilaterals including Islamic Development Bank, we're all working towards this pretty much the same goal. Now let's kind of just give you a very quick overview of what is the status of SMEs. Now SMEs are known to be an engine for the growth. More and more realization is happening that if in a country you want to achieve very high economic growth, you need to promote SMEs. There are about 400 million SMEs all over the world, but it's kind of a very sorry to see that only 26 million SMEs are in a formal sector, which means all the rest, about 370-odd SMEs, are not in a formal sector. They are basically surviving at their own. They do not have any support in terms of finance or maybe on the infrastructure. The third column shows you what is the gap between the demand and the supply. Means that what is the demand for financing of these SMEs and what is the gap? And you could see that in East Asia and Pacific, there are about 92% gap, which is huge. And luckily in the Middle East and North Africa, it is less, it's about 10%. But in East Asia and South Asia, this gap is very huge. So that sets the stage of, you know, why we need to think about providing finance to micro and SME enterprises. Now, this thing is, as you know, I mean, for the last couple of years, World Bank is conducting a survey called Enterprise Survey, and that survey is done more than, I think, 50,000 different enterprises, and the data is collected. Now, this kind of this chart shows you that what is the main obstacle for SMEs, and on the top of the main obstacle is access to finance. And on the left side, you will see that there is a comparison between OIC countries and the rest of the world. And this, the bottom one is shows the OIC countries have this problem much severe than the rest of the world. So not only that access to finance is a problem with the whole throughout the world, but in OIC countries and Muslim countries, that problem is more profound. On the right-hand side, the same thing gives you a breakdown with different regions, and you can also, the right-hand side gives you that what is the access to finance for the large firms, and you will see that large firms do not have the same issues as the small firms. Now, when we ask that, okay, what is the main obstacle in accessing, getting a loan or financing, and again, the main issue comes out as biggest problem is lack of appropriate collateral. And the reason why people say lack of appropriate collateral, because if you look at the conventional debt-based financing, any debt-based financing will require a collateral. On the left-hand side, it tells you that again, problem is more profound for OIC countries. On the right-hand side, it tells you by which region. In the South Africa, in Sub-Saharan Africa region, it's very huge. And then the same problem is South Asia. This problem is very huge, which means that because these small firms and micro enterprise do not have any collateral, therefore they are unable to get access to credit or funding by any formal sector, including banking and so. So I think the data is very clear that we have a severe issues. Now, another important question which we looked at the enterprise survey and which has a lot of relevance for Islamic finance is that what is the source of financing your fixed assets? Remember, the fixed assets are something very heavy ticket items, and these are the ones which are small enterprises have the most difficulty to acquire. And this chart shows us that the biggest source of financing for fixed asset is basically your internal funds or your retained earnings, and the bank credit is very small. Now, why I like this chart is very, it has a relevance, because remember this thing that this is a fixed asset, which is a pure real economic asset, and that's, I will relate that later on to what is the relevance with Islamic finance. But main message is that the big ticket items of fixed assets, they are financed, not financed by any formal channel. So, now, what are the just summary of the issues on the demand side and supply side? Why issues are on the demand side? Main issue is that you have there's no collateral. The interest rate or the financing charges are high because, of course, there's no collateral, there's no credit history and so forth. Plus, there's no technical assistance available. The red tape and cost of doing business, all that thing creates impediments or challenges on the demand side. On the supply side, when you go to the banker and say that, okay, why don't you provide financing for these people? And they say, oh, we cannot do it because we don't have a credit history for these enterprises. The risk is very high, risk perception is very high, the cost of the probability of failure is very high. That's why we cannot give these loans. So this is really an issue that the SMEs and micro, which are very important for economic growth, are not getting the credit. So what do we do about it? Just, I think you have heard a lot about, you know, Islamic finance and relevance, but I want to just bring kind of a two ideas. What research has shown that Islamic finance has two key pillars by which it can promote, eliminate some of the challenges of Islamic finance. First is that it is based on the principles of risk sharing, which means that it is more entrepreneurship promoting, more friendly for the entrepreneurship. Second thing is it is an asset-based or asset-backed financing. And that links to my earlier chart, which I was showing that the fixed assets, which are asset, qualify to be a financed through a Sharia-compliant financing. For that, you don't need collateral. The asset itself becomes a collateral. So that is a very good kind of a, you know, well, argument of saying that Islamic finance could help where the conventional finance has failed. Other part is for very poor people, for the financial inclusion purposes, Islam has a well-defined instruments of redistribution. And that means, of course, zakat, qarz-e hasan, waqf, and all these other instruments, which are meant for this distribution of income as well as the assets, and it is supposed to be promoting shared prosperity. Now, history is full of cases where the waqf was used for providing, you know, helping poor people with their financing. Qarz-e Hasan is another potential. In Pakistan, there's a very well-known organization by name of Ahuwat, which is providing microfinancing and is purely run on Qarz-e Hasan. Similarly, other countries have similar, you know, microfinancing, or, you know, schemes available. So I think theoretically, there is a very strong case that Islamic finance, if implemented correctly, properly, can lead to resolving these issues of providing financing for poor people as well as and SMEs and for resolving the issue of financial inclusion. Now, I know that we have limited time, so I'm going to skip some of these charts, things which we, you know. Now, why we think that Islamic finance is more, you know, relevant for this thing? Of course, I mentioned one reason is because of its idea of risk sharing and asset-based finance, which also, you know, provides a very good strong argument. In addition to that, the whole idea of economic and social justice and provides you, makes everyone socially responsible, that they need to take care of the society, of the community, and that gives us another argument of using Islamic finance. Now, what are the key challenges? I think one of the, again, you know, Muslim countries are not the only one who are facing this problem. In our first slide, I showed you that many other countries which are having issues of low financial inclusion. I think one thing is that because of, you know, the last couple of years, the redistributive instruments of Islam like Zakat, Qarz-e Hasan, Waqf and all those other instruments have not been very active. So I think the first thing is to kind of use them for the intended purpose, and I already see this thing happening. IDB is working on many of these initiatives on Islamic social finance, which is very good. I also see countries like Malaysia or Indonesia, there's a concept of Waqf is picking up. But I think other Muslim countries also need to come up with a good holistic strategy how to revive these instruments and use them for poverty alleviation. So that's the one kind of a policy recommendation we will make. Second thing is, just like Islamic finance doesn't have an enabling environment in many countries, and they don't have an equal kind of a, equal footing in many ideas, same happens for micro and SMEs. So I think the regulators and the policy makers need to make sure that they give Islamic finance a fair chance, and in that terms of, in terms of a proper regulation, governance structure, and also tax advantages, make sure that the Islamic finance doesn't have a tax disadvantage. So these are the, you know, one of the issues which we, some of the policy recommendations which can be made. Other thing is that I think we can do a lot of financial engineering to mix the different products which are commercially viable products like Muraba, Mudaraba and those with these Islamic redistributive institutions, like using, mixing with the Waqf, mixing with the Qarz-e Hasan, mixing with the other things. Like, so in that sense, we could come up with a hybrid instruments which can be used for financing of SMEs and as well as for the micro. So I think that needs to be paid attention, and that it will give a quite a bit, it will have a lot of potential. Now, I think I'm not going to go into detail. There is a study which was done under G20 last year with collectively with IDB and the World Bank on how to leverage Islamic finance for SMEs. Some of these recommendations were made over there that SMEs have a highest chance of failure in the very first year. So how do we can provide them help in at every stage, at initial stage, at a growing stage, at a maturity stage? And there's a long kind of list of recommendations which I, unfortunately, we cannot go through at this time, given the shortage of time, but you know, you can access the report and look at it. There are some key recommendations about how to promote SMEs, and then main idea again is, just to summarize, is that theoretically there's no doubt that Islamic finance and its products do offer a very comprehensive set of tools which can be used to provide financing for micro and SME finance. However, the question is, how do we make it happen? For that, we need to have proper, adequate policy implementation. We have to encourage Islamic finance, and we have to provide them an equal level playing field. We need to have a strategy for financial inclusion. We need to have strategy for using Islamic financial products of for financial inclusion. And I think the main key message is that we need to have come up with a better innovative tools which use the risk sharing and asset based finance as far as, and in addition to the redistributive products of Waqf and Karze Hasan and Zakat, mix them together, create a hybrid products which can provide you this, provide a very viable option for financing of micro and SMEs. So with that, I'll be happy to take, I'm looking forward to hearing the comments from my colleagues and then later on question from you. With that, thank you so much for your attention. Assalamu alaikum.
We have another speaker, Mark Mustafa Ansari, the IOFI Deputy Secretary General, who will be speaking on the same topic, about 15 minutes.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. Thank you very much for being here in the last session, particularly after lunch. And I can see people trying to like sitting at the corner seats so that running away is easy. So I must thank you all to be here for that time. And this is the most difficult time to have a presentation in front of the guys who have already taken, alhamdulillah, good lunch, and they are just waiting for the session to end. So I'll try my level best to like keep it with it. I'll start with a small example, a management lesson, and in the meanwhile, I will request our friends there to put my presentation. Thank you very much. A management lesson that I would like to share with you is a very quick one. Some years back, a few decades back, a new chief executive was appointed in Coca-Cola, and he was. Obviously, whenever a new chief executive comes, you know all the time he has the targets and pressures that you have to increase the sales and you have to increase the market share and all that. So the first task that he asked all the respective managers and finance guys to bring up reports of the market share. He got those reports shortly, and all the reports were like identifying that this is Coke, this is Pepsi, and this is others, Coke Group, Pepsi Group, and others. And in certain markets we have gained 1%, in certain markets we have lost 1%. The guy was different, and I want Islamic finance to be different in the same manner. He said that I don't want this report. I don't want this report how much you have gained against Pepsi or lost against Pepsi. I want this report to be based on total human intake of liquids. How much every human being is taking in form of liquids, all sort of it, cold beverages, hot beverages, water, liquor, whatever it is. I want this report against that. And my target market is that. Total Pepsi and Coke combined would be only, maybe 5% of total human intake if we take it at max. But human beings need to have some liquid. So we need to make available Coke to them everywhere whenever they feel thirsty. So they started having expansions with regard to, for example, vending machines. They put vending machines everywhere. Wherever you feel like thirsty, you should be having an access to a vending machine where you can have Coke. That's what I want to talk to Islamic finance guys here. Don't look at the share that you are gaining against conventional. See towards the universe which is wide open. 90% in most of the Islamic countries, around 90%, 80% plus market is unbanked. And that is the area where you can tap. And that is the area, if you tap it, you will not be having the problems like Mr. Noor Abid and Mr. Ashar Nazim are identifying, that $500 billion of Islamic finance funds. The fund that you obtain from the loyal customers, faith-driven customers, that they are putting their money in Islamic finance, and you put that money with conventional banks. Why you are doing that? Because you are not looking at the universe. The universe is important here, and that universe is the unbanked market, the people who don't have access to finance, the people who don't have access to any sort of financial services. That is something very important. I believe that if we start focusing on that area, we will solve most of the problems that we are actually facing right now. The questions that have been posed have been like, the questions that have been posed have been very crucial, and obviously within the limited time we can't answer them all. My presentation is primarily based on two parts. One part is regarding a few key important, few key considerations and recommendations, and the second part is regarding a comprehensive model for credit guarantee or credit takaful scheme for SMEs primarily, but additionally it can be used for micro. The idea is that Islamic finance is growing, but it is growing in a disproportionate manner. The asset base is not growing in a manner, particularly if we talk about genuine banking assets. I'm not talking about just the placements or investment that you make with conventional banks or with government sukuk. I'm talking about the thing that you need to do banking. You are not brokers, or you are not commission agents of the government to get money for them, getting money from the public and putting in sukuk or putting in conventional banks. You are not brokers, you are bankers. And if you are bankers, then you need to work on the asset side equally well. Unfortunately, that is a weak side. So our disproportionate growth is impacting the situation that we are not contributing towards the economic development of respective countries and the Ummah as a whole. Our assets are not that much increasing as compared to genuine assets. I'm talking about genuine banking assets, the investing and financing assets. So the quick question, is Islamic banking achieving its objectives with regard to economic development? Do we really agree that it is something that we need to do, or it is just a commercial venture to make money? I believe, yes, it's a commercial venture, but at the same time, it has some social responsibilities and some responsibilities towards the Ummah and towards their respective countries. And for that purpose, they need to identify the areas where they need to contribute. Quick identification of few basic issues that are not allowing Islamic finance to move towards the right direction. There are three main issues if you see. The first one is leaders' mindset. I can see still people who are not fully convinced. I saw a chief executive, he was asked why you guys are not doing microfinance while there is still a lot of place where you can have. He said, yeah, we are very much interested about it because the rate of interest that is charged in microfinance is really good. We want to venture into it. Now you can see the mentality. Either they don't want to go into it at all, or if they want to go into it, they want to exploit the 40% rate in certain markets. So that is one thing. Obviously, we need to work from top to bottom to top and top to bottom. We need to work with the top guys as well, and we need to let them understand. And we need to let them understand that we are not talking about losing money. We are talking about identifying new avenues of making good money through a responsible way. On the regulatory side, there is one big issue, the capital adequacy requirements. If I put money in Sukuk, I am safe. No capital requirement. But if I put money with SME, double the capital requirement. Why I should go for it? It's a hindrance. Actually, genuinely it's a hindrance that people are facing that. Scholars are lying less preferred mode. I'm not a scholar. I don't want to criticize anybody. But our Sharia standard, EU Sharia standard says that tawarruq is a less preferred mode. It should be used in emergency only. Then why banks are having 70% portfolio of tawarruq only? And tawarruq for used for personal finance. Tawarruq used for placing money with conventional banks. What we are doing actually? Are we actually doing banking? So these three things, this vicious circle. On one side there is the mindset, second side there are regulatory impediments, and the third side there are allowabilities of certain products which make the thing simple. If I can work through tawarruq, I don't need any other product. Quickly, I don't want to, don't have time, so I'm not going to evaluate all the markets analysis, but you can see only the Middle East. You can see the only 14% have bank account. And it would include the salaried people who must have a bank account in order just to get their salaries. As compared to world average of 60%. And now 60% of world average includes other regions, as Dr. Zubeen Iqbal mentioned, regarding, including, you can see, India, China, Pakistan, Indonesia, large population countries where the ratio is not good. So if you cannot compare it at all with the developed world. And this ratio is speaking of the need of re-evaluation how we are doing our banking. And we need to re-evaluate the example that I've given with regard to Coke. You need to identify the total human needs in financial services. You need to find out solutions, and inshallah you can find out good solutions. When there is a will, there is a way. And if you don't want to do something, you will have thousands of reasons to justify that. Now, coming to the Middle Eastern market, we are particularly talking about Middle Eastern Saudi market, because right now we are not focusing on all the Islamic countries. For this purpose, I would say that SME finance is more important as compared to microfinance because of the economic factors, because of the individual financing limits and things like that. Here I have identified a few key important points here. For SME finance, for the banks who want to venture into this development activity, economic development support activity, they should first be choosing the SME finance. Why? It has lower admin cost, it has more efficiency most of the times, then it creates employment. Everybody can't be an entrepreneur. That is an important point that we need to understand. Having worked with several microfinance institutions and have done some studies on microfinance, I can tell you for sure that a few people on the lowest ladder of economic activity or the lowest level of poverty are there because they lack skills. And you cannot develop skills in people. You can help them getting skills, you can help them getting trainings, but you can't develop a skill in somebody. But still, those guys can be good employees if they are provided relevant skills. So everybody can't be an entrepreneur. Everybody can't have those skills which are necessary to do a business. So it has to be a mix. Micro is important, but SME is also important. SMEs also create employment for those guys who can't be entrepreneur themselves. But still, it helps in economic activity and it has a better economy scale as compared to the microfinance activity. SME finance can work well at their own without significant intervention and with minimum capacity buildings. For macro, you need more capacity building. For SME, you need less capacity building and you need less government and donor interventions. Supports technological advancements. With micro, you can't support technological advancements. But with SME, for sure, you can have technological advancements and you can get benefit of it. You can have an example of China in front of you. A huge success that China has got is the technological advancement, and that technological advancement was not limited to big corporates. It was also there in the service industry and it was there in the small enterprises and medium enterprises. On the microfinance, you will have high admin costs, particularly in the Middle Eastern market. The administrative cost is quite high, so generally you won't find it feasible, honestly. Lesser efficiencies, entrepreneurship created with some employment. Yes, surely that is a positive. Can't work well if their own unless training and value chain creation intervention is made. That is an important point, that microfinance cannot easily work on a sustainable basis, on a long-term basis, unless there are capacity building activities attached to it and unless there are certain interventions with regard to support and with regard to value chain creation is made. And normally does not support the technological advancements. It's not easy in the micro sector to have technological advancements. So if you want to have technological advancements, you need to support SME. I have a few points related to microfinance, but I will skip them. Now, the question is why normally SME financing and the development sector financing is not preferred by banks? What is the problem? What they are feeling? One of the important things is no incentive. They don't feel any incentive. They have higher capital requirements. So no, normally incentives are not there. Yes, there are interventions, there are some incentives, but in Muslim world, generally you won't find those incentives at a reasonable level. High risk, low return. In the end, you end up with less return, and obviously, with regard to other regulatory impediments, it becomes further difficult. Weak collaterals, weak or no collaterals are there, so that is again a problem. And when the economy is hit, you are in deep trouble. weak structure and no governance. Those institutions generally have no governance process within them. So you cannot expect very good governance or very good financial results or financial reporting or transparency from them. More transactions and less amounts as compared to corporate and investment and sukuk deals. And bank shortcomings, that is, expertise is not there, facilities are not there to support these sectors. I have a summary of a few interventions that different governments and central banks have done in different countries, what activities they have done. You will rarely find out any Muslim countries here. The intervention models that they use, for example, increased amount of government loan guarantees, special guarantees, increased government export guarantees, and pension fund co-financing. All these things you can see, all those countries that we have selected data from are non-Muslim countries mainly. Increased direct lending to SMEs, you see, you won't be able to identify. So these are the things that Muslim countries and OIC countries need to do, and our central banks need to identify these avenues. Tax exemptions, deferments, credit mediation, bank targets for SME lending, central bank funding. You can see all these are the intervention strategies that are applied by different governments and central banks for promoting the SME sector. But you cannot find out Muslim governments generally there. In Saudi Arabia, I know that there is a credit guarantee scheme, and I'm told that it is, but I was unable to find out when Mr. Zameer Iqbal kindly identified that there is some good scheme going on. Although schemes have been introduced in several other countries as well. For example, in Pakistan, there is a scheme, but those schemes, at least as far as I know, these are not working very well as of today. Now, what are the barriers, what we need to take care of? Unstable profitability, survival, and growth brings special financing problems. Owners and managers often lack commercial experience as entrepreneurs. That's a big problem. Lack of loan guarantee programs. Practice to avoid regular account keeping makes it difficult to evaluate credit worthiness. Most of, particularly in that small sector, you won't find out proper accounts and proper financial reporting. So that's a big problem. Sole proprietor of family businesses where owners are reluctant to obtain conventional interest-based financing. Obviously, that's a problem. Islamic finance is the solution to that, but we are talking about the main impediments that are there. Then you can identify the Basel III, a 2 and 3 requirements with regard to capital and provisioning and credit internal rating or external rating. All these things are putting additional pressure. High risk of financing, you can see that from a commercial banking mindset, you will find out high risk of financing. FI's lack of capacity to evaluate SME credits. Now, you can evaluate, your credit departments can evaluate the performance of corporate, big corporate, but they are not trained, they don't have capacity to evaluate the performances of small and medium enterprises. That's a big lack. With this presentation, as I mentioned earlier, I want to propose a credit takaful, self-sustainable credit takaful model. Obviously, I don't have enough time. How much time should I have left with? Okay, thank you. So the idea is that this is a model that can be used by central banks and governments to set up a self-sustaining takaful fund for SME financing. The issues that we have identified, those issues can be tackled through setting up this sort of activity. Right now what is happening, even if some donor funds are there, even if some government funds are there, these are directly allocated to the relevant sector and directly passed on in form of subsidy. The idea that I'm talking about is a bit different. What I'm proposing, that is, you develop a takaful fund, credit takaful fund. You calculate the minimum benchmark price that every bank participating in this one should get. And it can be equivalent to the government bond rate, or it can be even more than that. This becomes the base rate. Above the base rate, you add the admin cost, and you add the risk of loss, risk premium. So you identify the rates which are applicable to individual customers. And this has to be worked out primarily based on industry, and then later, for individual customers, identifying the individual impediments. The idea is that that every bank who participates in this scheme shall be nearly guaranteed, nearly, obviously we are talking about Islamic finance, so we cannot 100% guarantee most of the things, but it can be nearly guaranteed the minimum benchmark rate, which is a little bit above the government benchmark rate. There will be additional one requirement, that is the capital adequacy, on which respective central banks have to provide some relaxation. Once this is done, the banks will be, for example, if I'm placing some money with another bank and having the government benchmark rate, if I'm getting little bit more than that by putting in this fund, I'll be getting more. So how this fund will be working, this is the incentive. You put in this fund and you make almost secure return a little bit above the government rate of return. How we are going to do it?
I'll just like to be
The governments have to provide some seed capital, and that seed capital has to be primarily a replacement for the subsidies that already the governments are providing to small and medium enterprises and to specific sectors. So that subsidy can be used one time to provide the seed capital for this fund. Now, every Islamic bank will be charging risk premium. With risk premium, for example, we take an example that the government benchmark rate is 5%, and we take 2% for admin cost, and we take 5% for risk premium for a specific industry. So it makes of 12%. We charge the customer 12%, and the bank gets 6%, that is 1% above the government benchmark rate, almost secured. How it will be secured? On a portfolio basis, and by combining all the subsidies that are coming in different forms. Most of the situation you will have subsidies coming in or donors funds coming in, but those are not organized in a structured manner like this. So if you put it like this and you put it based on a proper computation, you will be getting minimum return for each of the banks. Now there are two situations. Number one, you get a shortfall. Means that the risk premium is not calculated adequately and there is more risk and more losses. Generally it will not happen because it will be calculated with the margin. But if it happens, there will be short-term funding that may be required. And there is an option of having a re-takaful of the fund. If you have surplus, the surplus will first form reserves, and the second stage, the surplus will be redistributed to the banks who are performing better. So it will be an incentive for the respective bank as well, that it will be getting return more than the government benchmark rate if its performance is better. Its performance is better means the portfolio funded by that bank is getting a better return as compared to the other ones. Those sectors which are on the priority list of the governments and central banks, those can be provided even a lower rate, particularly if they can sustain a lower risk premium. Risk premium can be higher on different specific institutions, and it can be higher on different industries. For that, a mechanism has to be prepared based on a rating system. If different industries are to be funded at different rates, there can be different sub-funds that can be arranged for that. And each sub-fund will be providing a quota kaful coverage to each of the other sub-funds. No subsidy and no government support, no donor support will be directly passed on to the customer. All those funds will be coming to this pooled fund, so that wherever there is a deficit, that is catered. Claims of losses will be entertained 90% by the fund and 10% by the respective bank. That 10% risk has to be taken by the respective bank in order to ensure that it de-incentivize the risk of loss on the part of the bank, because otherwise there is a risk that certain banks may become careless in funding. So this incentive and the surplus distribution incentive will make sure that each of the bank remains careful with regard to the funding.
As I mentioned, Rita Kaful and internal Rita Kaful between the funds and Rita Kaful of the fund by the
governments as well as by the Rita Kaful, professional Rita Kaful entities will be ensured proper. Funds investments will be managed through proper mechanisms. Some of the banks will be using that as equity, but mostly it will be in more secured modes like government securities. Legal structures can be different, and it can be different from country to country. There can be different structures that we can have, and obviously there has to be proper governance mechanism from that pool, because it will be working as an association of banks, so there will be a proper mechanism. Reserves will be created according to actuarial advice and the calculations that you need to do with regard to the risks, future risk, total risk based on the portfolio. You will have to maintain investment risk reserve and maybe even surplus equalization reserves for that. So I believe there are further details, but I believe that we can discuss if there are any questions later on. Thank you very much for your time, and thank you very much, sir, for your extra time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Now we have three commentators. The first one is Mr. Basil Khanfal, the Microfinance Advisor at the ICD. Please, the floor is yours.
Yes. أوجه الشكر لمنظمي المؤتمر على دعوة المؤسسة الإسلامية لتنمية القطاع الخاص عضو مجموعة البنك الإسلامي للتنمية للحضور والمشاركة في هذا المؤتمر الهام جدا. بداية إضافة إلى ما ذكره زملائي الأخ إقبال والأخ أنصاري عن موضوع تمويل المنشآت أو تمويل الأصغر والمتناهي الصغر وعلى أهميته، يعني أعتقد أنه يحتاج إلى مؤتمرات ووقت مساحة من الوقت أكبر بكثير ما هو مخصص في هذا المؤتمر. أنا حقيقة حابب أضيف إلى ما أضافه زملائي إنه أكثر بتسليط الضوء على التمويل متناهي الصغر اللي هو المايكرو فاينانس الإسلامي. شعار المؤتمر هذا اللي هو تقييم تجربة التمويل أو المالية الإسلامية بعد مرور 40 عام. كشخص متخصص في التمويل الإسلامي الأصغر، يعني استحضرني أنه الآن موضوع التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي يشابه تماماً ما كانت عليه التمويل أو البنوك الإسلامية قبل 40 عام. ما زال في بدايته، ما زال وليداً. سأذكر بعض الحقائق اللي تظهر أن هذا القطاع ما زال يحتاج إلى دعم كبير، وقد نستفيد من تجربة البنوك الإسلامية في بداياتها والمراحل التي مرت بها والعقبات والتحديات والنجاحات التي حققتها، اللي عكسه على صناعة التمويل الأصغر اللي أنا برأيي أنها جدا مهمة، خصوصا إذا نعرف أنه تقريبا التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي لا يشكل أكثر من 0.5% من التمويل الأصغر العالمي. المؤسسات التي تعمل تقارير وترفع تقاريرها إلى مؤسسات الجمع معلومات عن مؤسسات التمويل الأصغر في العالم تشير أن عدد العملاء 220 مليون. عدد العملاء الذي يستخدم الأدوات الإسلامية في التمويل المتناهي الصغر تقريباً 1.25 مليون. يعني إحنا نتكلم على تقريباً 0.5% من التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي من مجموع التمويل الأصغر العالمي. 80% من أو 90% من منتجات التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي مركزة في المرابحة، وليس هناك أي تنوع في المنتجات. 82% من التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي متركز في 3 دول تقريبا في الدول الإسلامية اللي هي إندونيسيا وبنغلاديش والسودان. هذول 3 دول يحتلوا 82%. التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي، عدد المؤسسات اللي بتقدم تمويل أصغر إسلامي في العالم لا تتعدى 300 مؤسسة مقابل عشرات الآلاف من مؤسسات التمويل الأصغر على مستوى العالم كله. هذه بعض الإحصائيات وبعض الحقائق لبيان مدى صغر أو مدى بدايات هذا القطاع في الدول العربية والإسلامية، واللي أنا يعني أتمنى أن يأخذ اهتماما عند الحديث عن المالية الإسلامية واعتباره جزء من المالية الإسلامية. المالية الإسلامية ليست فقط هي ما تقوم به البنوك الإسلامية على أهميتها طبعا، ولكن من يعني هي دعوة للشمول المالية الإسلامية يعني لتصل إلى كافة القطاعات. أكثر من 75% من الوطن العربي أو الإسلامي من البالغين ليس لديهم أي حسابات، بسبب أنه هذول هم يمثلوا الشريحة اللي هي أقل من المتوسط والشريحة الفقيرة، أو خلينا نقول شريحة محدودي الدخل، يعني لا أريد أستخدم كلمة الفقر كثير في الموضوع. فهي دعوة للمالية الإسلامية والقائمين على المالية الإسلامية لتنويع والوصول إلى شرائح أكثر ما هي مواصلة الآن. المالية الإسلامية حالياً أنا برأيي أو البنوك الإسلامية ما زالت تتعامل مع اللي هم نخبة الأعمال ونخبة المجتمع والشركات الكبيرة، ولكن وصولها إلى الشركات الصغيرة ما زال محدوداً بالشكل العام، وإلى الشريحة اللي احنا نسميها التمويل الأصغر أو الميكروية للأسف قد أجزم أنها لا تساوي يعني أكثر يعني في أحسن التفاؤلات 0.25% من محفظتها. طبعا هناك في تحديات كبيرة أمام التمويل الإسلامي الصغير، بقدر أجملها أو ألخصها بشكل سريع، إنه إلى الآن ما زلنا نفتقر إلى وجود نموذج عملي نموذج ناجح ومستدام. جميع المؤسسات هذه ما زالت تعتمد على المانحين أكثر ما هي تعتمد على القطاع الخاص أو على دور المستثمرين في التمويل الإسلامي. الشيء الثاني، قدرات المؤسسات ما زالت في بدايتها. مفهوم دمج النواحي الشرعية في التمويل الأصغر ما زالت في هناك افتقار لهذه الخبرة وافتقار للممارسة. ما زالوا حتى لما مؤسسات التمويل الأصغر تتبع المنهجية أو تتبع منتجات متوافقة مع الشريعة الإسلامية، ما زال القائمين على العملية هاي أو من الموظفين أو على مختلف المستويات الإدارية ما زال لديهم عدم القدرة، لأنه هم فقط ينفذوا عبارة عن تعليمات دون ما يكون في هناك مرجعية شرعية واضحة. جميع مؤسسات التمويل الأصغر للأسف تفتقر إلى وجود هيئات شرعية متخصصة تستطيع أنها تساهم في بناء هذه الصناعة. من التحديات التنظيم أو البنوك المركزية كيف تنظر لهذا القطاع، لا زال ولو أن الآن بدأنا نشهد تطور إيجابي، لكن كثير من البنوك المركزية في الدول الإسلامية نظمت التمويل الأصغر، ولكن إلى الآن لم تنظم التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي، ما زالت تتعامل معه كجزء من التمويل الأصغر بشكله العام التقليدي والإسلامي. يعني ليس هناك لوائح أو تعليمات أو قوانين مختصة في مؤسسات التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي، لكن في هناك محاولات في بعض الدول الإسلامية جادة مثل إندونيسيا، مثل ماليزيا، السودان، في هناك محاولات مبشرة ممكن الاستفادة منها ونقل تجربتها إلى باقي الدول الإسلامية. تنويع المنتجات هذه واحدة من أكبر المشاكل. ما زال الغالبية العظمى من مؤسسات التمويل الأصغر تعتمد على منتج المرابحة فقط. في بعض المحاولات برضو يعني لا نستثنيها أو يجب ذكرها اللي هو في اللي هي المشاركة، ولو إنها لا تشكل 2% من مجموع إذا أخذنا كعدد العملاء كمقياس. السلم في بعض الدول خصوصا مثل السودان، لكن المرابحة ما زال هو المسيطر على هاي المنتجات، وهذا قد يكون أحد المعيقات في نمو الوصول إلى أعداد أكثر. الدراسات أظهرت أنه كثير من تم مسح أو عمل دراسات ميدانية، كثير من اللي تم سؤالهم على مدى إرضاهم عن مؤسسات التمويل الأصغر الإسلامية كان هناك في رغبة جدا كبيرة، لكن لما تيجي على التنفيذ الواقعي للأسف كان ينزل النسبة، نزلت من 75% تقريبا من اللي كان يفضل أن يكون التمويل الإسلامي، في الناحية العملية نزل لأقل من 1% بسبب عدم وجود منتجات تلبي احتياجات هذه العملاء، بالإضافة إلى التكلفة. طبعاً التكلفة كانت واحدة من العوامل الرئيسية، وطول الإجراءات، وخصوصاً يعني إحنا التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي مفهومه هو عبارة عن مبالغ صغيرة تعطى لفئة قادرة على العمل لكن لا تستطيع الوصول إلى مصادر التمويل التقليدية، فهي تحتاج إلى سرعة في الإنجاز. التمويل، مؤسسة التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي للأسف إلى الآن ما زال هذه الآليات أو الكفاءة في التشغيل ما زالت ضعيفة، هاي من ضمن التحديات. حبيت أعطي نظرة بس عن التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي. في كمان من ضمن الشيء اللي أنا حابب فيه المالية الإسلامية أن تتوسع فيه هو شمول التمويل الأصغر كأحد أدوات المالية الإسلامية، وخصوصاً أنه الشريحة الأكبر في عالمنا العربي والإسلامي هي شريحة ذوي الدخل المنخفض أو الناس التي لا تستطيع الوصول إلى مصادر الدخل أو مصادر التمويل التقليدية. من الأمور كمان اللي حاطة كنقطة يجب الإشارة إليها، يوجد في العالم تقريباً 100 صندوق استثمار في التمويل الأصغر برأس مال يتجاوز 10 مليارات دولار، رأس المال المدفوع في هاي الصناديق، ولا واحد من 100 أو 110 صناديق الموجودة حاليا يستهدف التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي. أنا يعني حبيت أعطي هذه المعلومات لبيان كنتيجة لوجودكم هون أن نبدأ نفكر في كيفية إضافة شيء جديد للمالية الإسلامية لتعميم فائدتها وانتشارها بين مجتمعاتنا. من 110 صناديق لا يوجد ولا صندوق يستهدف التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي. هلا ليس ما عندهم مانع يتعاملوا مع التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي من ناحية تجارية، ولكن كصناديق تتبع أو لديها منتجات تتوافق مع الشريعة الإسلامية ولا واحد من هذا 110 صناديق. فأنا حبيت أنتهز هذه الفرصة المؤتمر للإضاءة أكثر على موضوع التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي، وأتمنى أن يكون من ضمن شمولية المالية الإسلامية بشكل عام وليس فقط على البنوك الإسلامية بمفهومها التقليدي. شكراً لكم.
Showed a very gloomy picture about the SME as well as the microfinance situation for when it comes to the Islamic world and Islamic banking. I want to share with you some perspectives that goes in line with what particularly the three speakers have spoken about in terms of certain action steps that have been taken from a Jordanian perspective and perspective of Islamic International Brand to tackle the challenges and deal with the microfinance as well, particularly SME maybe more, in a way that could be quote-unquote durable and conducive to development and contributing in the future, should it continue with the same stream that is going on nowadays, to the development that I think I'm happy that Mr. Mr. Zamir Halfani started with saying that basically what we aim at is to link between how SME contribution and how more banking services to SME, Sharia compliant, could contribute to development, which is again should be part and parcel of the goals of any financial institution. I think banks, everybody knows that we are in the business of making money, but we should not shy away from our very important responsibility, especially when we have in our name Islam as part of our name. We have to be in line with the, so to say, the, part and parcel of what Islam is after is I'mar al-Ard. I'mar al-Ard meaning development, meaning progress, meaning better future for the for generations and better life. SME is known to if you look at all over the globe, SME companies constitute in most of the countries more than 90% of the companies operating. If you don't have proper banking for SMEs, particularly Sharia compliant banking, it's very impossible for you to grow. But it is very impossible, I personally think, because I come from Jordan where most of the SMEs would like to deal with it in Sharia compliant manner. If this is not provided by Islamic banks, they are not willing to go for banking at all because they feel, I don't want we'd rather do it with our own money, no matter how small it is, rather than go to conventional banks and be subject to rebound financing. From this standpoint, and talking about the challenges that probably most of the speakers have talked about, Mr. Zamir spoke about collateral as one of the challenges, and the interest rate, which I want to use the word pricing or cost of borrowing, and the third one is technical assistance or know-how. At our end, we managed to sign an agreement with a loan guarantee company, which is called the Jordan Loan Guarantee Company, to have those SMEs being guaranteed by a program which we have created and made it Sharia compliant by the name of Kafala. So those SMEs will be guaranteed by this fund up to 70% of the loan. So this care of the collateral condition that usually is inherited and it's the factor that deprives SMEs from having access to finance. Secondly, because I was talking before this session with Mr. Zamir about the argument that high cost of interest rate does not hinder growth from SMEs, I totally disagree and agree with him that if you have very high interest rate, this is a recipe for disaster for SMEs. So you have to have a very, very tailor-made subsidized pricing for SMEs. And accordingly, everybody knows that Jordan enjoys good relationship with most of the countries, including international organizations. Not to mention World Bank as being an example. World Bank is giving Jordan lots of soft loans for SME financing. Central Bank is making those funds available to banks, and we managed to sign with our Central Bank Wakala agreement whereby we are entrusted to the funds and restricted Wakala whereby we make it available to SMEs at a very, very low pricing, which is even lower than the pricing available to large corporates. This also has been a very success story, and even when the World Bank people came to audit they said this is a story to tell. The third one, which is the technical assistance, we managed to have technical assistance bodies in major business centers and our branches whereby those provide technical assistance in terms of ability to do financials, to prepare financials, to have a bankable proposition, to prepare cash flows, to understand assets and liabilities and the accountancy and blah, 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 whereby those SMEs are now able to put together a very bankable proposition to banks, and this has taken care of this, again, limitation. Recently, again, I'm very impressed by this suggestion of Mr. Omar about the CAFL issue. We have done something similar in Jordan, which has been launched a couple of months back. It's called the Startup Funds. The Startup Fund, as I said, seed capital has been put by the Central Bank of 5 million JDs, and Islamic banks have put, as Qat Hassan, 5 million JDs. So we have 10 million JDs of fund. this $10 million JD is put in one of the Islamic banks investment account, whereby all the income that comes from it is given to subsidize the possibility of loss of startups, whereby the loan guarantee company, of course, this $10 million is given to the loan guarantee company. Whatever amount of profit they make out of it from the Islamic or Shelter Research plan is put in a fund where any delinquency that takes place is this excess fund is used to cover up for this. And the loan guarantee company guarantees up to 85% of the loan that's given to the startup. Of course, whatever bank is active, because all the banks will have to give this money as hard hassle. But if you are active, you get it back when you finance. So the bank which is active in financing SMEs, startups particularly, because usually startups get the most difficult part of the SME financing, because usually if you're a startup, nobody will touch you unless there is a really strong scheme of guarantee. This has been launched a couple of months back and it's showing good progress. Just share here a piece of information I want to share with you. Last year, the total guaranteed funds that we gave to through the loan guarantee company reached $35 million. There is zero delinquency. Zero. Z-E-R-O delinquency. So basically, you can always grow. The growth so far for the last 3 years, year on year, is more than 35%. Again, somebody will argue that the amount is still small. It's small, small. But when you have year on year 35%, in a very short period of time, hopefully this will grow to a very dynamic level. So maybe just in a summary, I want to say that there is three pillars of success. If you have cheap financing, collateral available, no need for collateral, and financial technical assistance to SMEs, you could in a way take care of the bulk of the challenges that this sector faces, particularly when you know that there is lots of spiled up in Islamic banks. As Mr. Rao said, they're being put somewhere in the West, where because there is no, available usage for them in terms of investment or lending. I wanted to share with you this our perspective to shed some little bit positive light. It seems to be that there is light at the end of the tunnel. Thank you very much.
The final speaker is Mr. Ayman Amin Sajidi, Chief Executive Officer at Ben Al Haida. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Again, thank you very much for the organizers for this important event. I'd like to highlight the importance of SMEs in the world that we live in. Just to give you an example of some statistics that I was able to gather is Egypt, the SMEs actually produce 80% of the GDP, and they are actually taking care of 75% of the employment. Pakistan, SMEs have 30% of the GDP, and they employ 78% of Pakistanis. Saudi, 33%. It employs 25%. Jordan is 50% and 50% employment. Morocco is 38% of GDP and it employs 50% employment in there. This shows you the importance of having SMEs in the countries that are surrounded by us. But yet, you find the lack of financing. For example, we got to know that only around 10% of SMEs get actually financing. Around 33% wouldn't need financing because their self-funding and they're so small that they circulate their own requirement. But then you have about 40+% SMEs that nobody has been talking with. We analyzed and tried to find out what's the reason or what's the cause of not getting this financing. It comes down to real basics from both sides. We figured out that most of the people that have created the SME businesses so want to create SME. Sometimes they haven't done even the basic studies whereby they prepare for the themselves a proper business plan. So putting up their sleeves and really thinking about what they want to do. They just want to jump into the middle of the sea and figure out maybe they will survive and swim back or maybe not. Maybe if we try to highlight that to any interested parties or individuals, that could help. But just this basic requirement is sometimes I found out is really lacking. The second part is exactly the same from the banking sector, whereby also the bankers have not been maybe properly equipped by understanding what it means being an SME. And sometimes they come down from large size financing departments down to SME, which is a whole different ballgame. So it helps again to provide both sides understanding of how to look at the businesses. Market information is really lacking. We don't have enough market information as part of the world already. Most of the countries, I would say, that also don't really support what the businesses require. But nevertheless, the attitude of people and the people that are surrounded by us, you find them all excited. They always want to do business. And we are a trader mentality in some parts are manufacturers. And we do have, as they say, the DNA. It just needs to go back into really how to shuttle it correctly and go forward. Just to find out also the crowdfunding requirement in this part of the world is almost at zero. We don't have any crowdfunding activity to my knowledge, except for, I think, Malaysia have started something there. But the rest of the Muslim world don't have it, and that could be a great source of funding. Of course, also another thing that could be very much helpful is if somehow the government supports a special sector, let's say that's strategic for the country, and they try to provide proper backing and maybe offtake of the products that get to be produced by those SMEs, could help those SMEs to go forward and get the proper financing, because then the funders will be more comfortable, and then eventually maybe the capital markets could help to close them in an SME or penny stocks structure or any of that particular businesses. That's basically the conclusion from my side. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We may have a few minutes for question and answer session. Is there any question from the floor today? One, two, three. So can we get a microphone, please?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. دكتور محمد البنيك، شكرا للمتحدثين، ولكن بس عايز اوضح نقطه مهمه بالنسبه ليه ان البنوك بتركز فقط او الجهات اللي بتقدم مشروعات صغيره، تمويل مشروعات صغيره، بتركز فقط على المرابحه، لان ما حدش من العاملين داخل هذه القطاعات يعرف غيرها. هي المرابحه هي الصيغه الوحيده اللي بيستوعبها ويطبقها. لكن فعليا في احد البنوك اللي احنا كنا بنحوله بنك اسلامي، فعلا كانت البنك بيقدم قطاع مشروعات صغيره عن طريق قروض وجزء من المرابحه. تم تحويل كل هذه التمويلات من المرابحه والقروض الى المشاركه. بعد ما كان التعثر في النسبه 7% 8%، بعد ما حولناها للمشاركه اصبحت نسبه التعثر فيها 0%. بس بعد ما تم اعداد نماذج واجراءات وتدريب العاملين، وكنا اصلا بنطلب كمان المتعاملين اللي هم اصلا ما يعرفوش هذا. فالقضيه المنظومه متكامله، يعني اهمها قناعه الاداره العامه بالبنك للتمويل، الاداره الجهات الرقابيه زي البنك المركزي المصري النهارده لما فرض على البنوك ان كل بنك يطبق 200 مليون جنيه مشروع صغير. فهي القضيه ان كانش هناك رهبه اكيد من القائمين على العمل المصرفي، زائد رهبه من البنك نفسه، ثم توعيه للقائمين على التنفيذ. دي نقطه مهمه جدا. واحب بس اذكر بحاجه قال معالي سعاده الشيخ صالح الحسين في حول اول تجربه عملها الدكتور احمد النجار، كان بدا ببنك الادخار لتمويل المشروعات الصغيره والمتوسطه وهو بنك اسلامي. فالقضيه قضيه ان احنا محمد يونس لما ذكر في كتابه جرامين بنك قال لك ان التجربه اللي عملها في بنجلاديش هو اصلا واخدها من احمد النجار. فالقضيه ان احنا ننشئ كوادر قادره على اداره هذه المشروعات، اعتقد تحقق النجاحات ان شاء الله. شكرا جزيلا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. نصلي ونسلم ونبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم. دكتور محمد الحسن عيسى الشرفي، نائب رئيس القضاء سابقا، و
وهي عضو مجلس أمناء الزكاة الأعلى لأمناء الزكاة وعضو المجلس الأعلى للأوقاف ومدقق في بعض البنوك في الرقابة الشرعية. أشكر المتحدث قبل الأخير الذي سرد لنا بعض الوقائع عن السودان، والحمد لله سبحانه وتعالى كل البنوك في السودان وبنص القانون تعمل وفق الشريعة الإسلامية، وقد وجه البنك المركزي كل البنوك أن تخصص جزء من عائداتها للتمويل الأصغر، ومتابع هذا الأمر ويسير سيرا طيبا، كما أن الزكاة تقوم بالعبء الأكبر في هذا المجال، وقد أنشأت معهدا للدراسة والمتابعة والتدريب للمتعاملين، وأصبحوا يملكون وسائل إنتاج حسب مقدرات الشخص الآخر. والحمد لله رب العالمين، من بيننا هنا في هذا الاجتماع أحد الأساتذة في هذا المعهد، وسار الأمر سيرا طيبا، وكنت آمل أن تكون لهذه المنظمة دراسات عن هذه التجربة السودانية، كما أن هيئة الأوقاف القومية تسعى جاهدة لتلحق بالرد، ونسعى بإذن الله تعالى لإنشاء هذه الشركات الوقفية التي طرحت، ونستفيد من تجارب الأخوة العاملين. ويا حبذا لو بعض الإخوة المقتدرين الذين يملكون من الأموال ويخرجون الزكوات بدل أن يوظفوها للمنظمات التي تعطيها للآخرين، كان الأجدر أن تعطى لهذه المنظمات حتى تستطيع أن تعمل في تنمية قدرات هؤلاء الناس، خاصة لكثرة الخريجين والشباب الذين أصبحوا في السودان وفي كل البلدان العربية الإسلامية حتى يوم تسعى لكسب العيش. شكرا جزيلا وجزاكم الله خيرا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. شكرا جزيلا لمنظمي هذا المؤتمر المهم جدا في الصناعة المالية الإسلامية بعد 40 عاما تقييم التجربة واستشراف المستقبل. فأحب بالنسبة لهذه التجربة أن أضيف التجربة التي حصلت في السودان، اللي خاصة بالموضوع الأخير اللي كان طرحه المعقب الأخير والمعقب الأول في هذه الجلسة، اليوم الموضوع المهم جدا في المالية الإسلامية ألا وهو التمويل الأصغر، التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي. وهنا التجربة في السودان وإن كان يعني في حقيقتها هي أهم التجارب العالمية الآن في مجال التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي، لأنه حصلت نتيجة لعمل منظم جدا تم ما بين البنك المركزي، بنك السودان المركزي، وما بين أكاديمية السودان للعلوم المصرفية والمالية، واللي أصلا بدأت فيها أنه كيفية تحويل التمويل الأصغر من مجرد مؤسسات إلى المجال الرسمي اللي هو الخاص بالجانب المصرفي. لأنه كان زي ما قال في الأول بدأ بمجرد منظمات مدعومة تعتمد على الدعم، لكن هنا لما التجربة الأساسية واللي حصلت فيها اللي هو كنا عملنا برنامج بناء قدرات لمدة 6 أشهر لحوالي 1100 خريج في مختلف المجالات ليصبحوا هم رواد التمويل الأصغر في المصارف السودانية. وكان التمويل كله في هذا البرنامج كان من بنك السودان المركزي، والتدريب تم في أكاديمية السودان للعلوم المصرفية المالية، ثم بعد ذلك في شهرين لمدة شهرين كاملات كان في تدريب ميداني لهؤلاء 1100 خريج في داخل المصارف السودانية وداخل مؤسسات التمويل الأصغر السودانية. الآن النجاح اللي ظاهر جدا أنه حول، لأنه حلو لو فعلا يا جماعة لو حاولنا نعرف التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي بالنسبة للتمويل الإسلامي، هو في النهاية التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي حيقود التجربة التمويلية الإسلامية. ليش؟ دي حاجة واحدة بس، لأنه التمويل الإسلامي أصلا قائم على تمويل مادي، يعني فيه جانبين، توازن بين الرجال والمالي والجانب المادي. التمويل الأصغر ما بيتم إلا بهذه الصورة، التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي ما بيتم إلا بهذه الصورة من خلال الصيغ الإسلامية. والحمد لله أبشر الأخ حتى الأخير أنه لا نعتمد فقط على صيغة المرابحة، وإنه طبقنا كل الصيغ الموجودة في عملية التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي داخل السودان. هذه العملية أدت إلى إيش؟ أدت الآن أصبح في السودان قاعدة كبيرة جدا للتمويل الأصغر، سواء كان بالنسبة للمعرفة أو المهارات اللازمة لتنفيذ مشروعات التمويل الأصغر، سواء كان بالنسبة لبعض التمويل الأصغر كويس أو بالنسبة لممارسي التمويل الأصغر، سواء كان المؤسسات غير المصرفية أو المؤسسات المصرفية. وقمنا عملناها بتجربة واضحة جدا أن التمويل الأصغر الإسلامي قد يكون أربح بالنسبة للمؤسسات الربحية أكثر من التمويل التقليدي العادي.
أوكي لا.
نعم.
Thank you very much. شكرا. Any of the panel members here would like to give comments? Yes. No, I mean, all three were talking about, the first one is on the issue of Marabah financing. That was the first issue. Okay. The other two is talking about, one is the using of the WACC for financing. And the other one is about the experience of Sudan in microfinance.
Well, I think I can maybe comment about the use of Wakaf. I think it's a, of course, technically it makes sense and it's a very good viable option. But I think the issue with Wakaf is that idea of Wakaf is to set aside a large sum of amount which can be invested or used somewhere, and the returns can be used for development purposes. But unfortunately, the level of poverty in the Muslim countries is so high that the amount of Wakaf which will need to create this thing will be in trillions of dollars. And that is where we are hitting a roadblock. And I give you one small example that these days there's a discussion about creating a Wakaf for refugees. However, if you look at the numbers, the total amount of funds needed for refugees is about $65 billion. And if you want to create a Wakaf, which will give you 5% per year, these days the yield levels are very low, it will almost be more than a couple of trillion dollars Wakaf to create. So I think Wakaf could work in at a community level, at a small society, city level or so, but when we talk about at a country level and cross-country for the Ummah, given the poverty level, Wakaf has certain limitations, kind of amount you need to achieve. But nevertheless, I think we need to come up with some solution where maybe we can create a market-based sukuk where we can use incentivize the Wakaf to invest on the sukuk, but those sukuk are for corporate social responsibility, for economic development, for SME financing and so. So Wakaf alone cannot, it can help with a very poor poverty level, but beyond that it has the demand, the need is much more.
أنا حديثي كان هو بالشكل العام، لم أخصص دولة بعينها. بالتأكيد ما سعيت إليه هو وضع الجميع أمام تحدي هذه الصناعة وأهميتها لأهميتها، وذكرت بعض الحقائق اللي هي أرقام مجمعة ولا تخص دولة بعينها. السودان متقدم، وأنا ذكرت هذا موضوع التمويل الأصغر متقدم، وتقدمه يعني حقيقة ونتكلم بصراحة إجا بسبب الفرض الإجباري وليس بسبب الفرض الاختياري. بمعنى العميل هناك ليس مخيرا بأن يأخذ ألف أو باء، هو فقط في اتجاه واحد، وهو بسبب القانون الريجوليشن ساندرز في السودان. السودان فيها منتج غير المرابحة، صحيح أنا قلت له 80-90% من منتجات المرابحة في السودان في السلم يطغى على المرابحة. في مصر كمان في هناك محاولات، القانون هيئة الرقابة المالية تقريبا له سنة، في هناك محاولات جادة لفرضه. شيء كويس بالسودان انه البنك المركزي يفرض على البنوك تخصص 12% من محفظتها للتمويل الأزهر، هذا كمان يشجع على كذا. استدراكا فقط، في تحدي لم أذكره في كلمتي يعني بسبب العجالة، عدم وجود هيئات شرعية متخصصة في التمويل الأزهر، واحدة من التحديات اللي أطرحها يعني ممكن يعني إن شاء الله مستقبلا يصير التفكير فيها والعمل عليها، وجود هيئات شرعية متخصصة في التمويل الأزهر لطبيعته اللي بتحتاج إلى بعض من التخصص. الشيء الثاني عدم وجود معايير للتقارير المالية أو معايير محاسبية متخصصة في التمويل الأزهر الإسلامي، ما نستخدمه الآن حتى في مؤسسات التمويل الأزهر الإسلامي هي المعايير الدولية International Accounting Standards، يعني ليس هناك معها. فهي دعوة لأوفي إنه يبدأوا في التفكير لوضع معايير محاسبية ومالية خاصة في التمويل الأزهر. شكرا.
Thank you very much. Mr. Ayman, how do you know? Okay,
yes. Comment, there is a fake belief from banks that if you go and finance SMEs, as if you're going to basically sacrifice because it doesn't make money. And basically you are in the business of making money. My comment here, each and every bank has something they call is a social responsibility budget, which they do to give for orphanage, for poor people, Mawa'id al-Ramadan, Mawa'id al-Rahman, packages for. I think it will be more fruitful if they put more emphasis on financing SMEs, and it will be, in my view, positive social responsibility. Because you can always give somebody fish, but to teach him how to fish would be better for the future. From our experience, just to comment, SME financing, even with the very low margin that we're making because of this subsidized sort of financing, is profitable, it gives jobs, it makes you feel better, and it contributes to social and economic development. This is not just saying it from up, it's in actual terms, and it has been proven over and over. Thank you.
Yes, I mean, just to say what you have said is essentially to really develop microfinance and SMEs is to have a whole ecosystem, which means that not only funding but also accounting, capacity building, as we mentioned earlier on in Sudan, all those technical subsidized financing, all those things will enable to support the development of microfinance. Yes, last comment.
I just want to make one comment here. I fully appreciate whatever activities are going on in different countries, and while I believe that these are not sufficient, yet these need to be appreciated. But what I would like to emphasize is that social capital is not sufficient. And we are talking about Islamic banking, and Islamic banking has a lot of commercial capital available, and it has a lot of commercial funds available from its investment account holders who want their funds to be invested in Sharia compliant avenues. What the idea that I'm talking about is providing enabling environment, for example, in line with some similar credit takaful schemes, in line with reduced regulatory requirements and reduced capital adequacy requirement with regard to these funds, which are invested with SME. The idea is to provide the commercial capital some conducive environment so that this commercial capital can be routed to SME and micro. Rather than we are looking for social capital and we are looking for donors and we are looking for government intervention all the time for the purpose of getting micro and SME financing. And we have lots of commercial capital available for these purposes, which is eventually ending up in the conventional banks or with the governments directly. So the idea is we need to identify the needs with regard to SME and microfinance, and we need to route the commercial capital that is available with Islamic banks towards these directions, and central banks and governments shall play the role to provide a conducive environment by making sure that they tackle the hurdles by providing takaful schemes, by providing capital adequacy support, by providing additional subsidies and additional funding wherever they can afford. But the idea is to make it self-sustainable. Otherwise, you won't be able to survive on social capital, let alone waqf. Waqf requires even more capital. But even providing social capital for these activities won't be possible, honestly.
Thank you very much. We are now the end of the session. Now I would like to request all of you to show our appreciation to all the speakers and the commentators. Now I hand over to Dr.
اللهم لك الحمد حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك. وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف خلق الله محمد بن عبد الله عليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. الإخوة الكرام، الأخوات الكريمات، لا يسعني في هذا اللقاء المبارك في خطاب هذين اليومين الحافلين إلا أن أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يجعل هذا اللقاء وهذا المؤتمر مؤتمرا مباركا، وأن يجعله من مجالس الذكر التي حفتنا فيه الملائكة وذكر الله في من عنده. أختم بعد شكر الله سبحانه وتعالى وأعيد الشكر والثناء لصاحب السمو الملكي أمير المنطقة المدينة المنورة بن فيصل بن سلمان، جزاه الله خيرا على دعمه الشخصي لهذا المؤتمر، على دعم عمارة منطقة المدينة المنورة، على دعم هيئة السوق المالية، على دعم الجامعة الطيبة واحتضانها لهذه الفعالية الكبيرة. لكم أيها المتحدثون والمعقبون الذين قطعتم الفيافي والقفار للحضور في هذا المكان المبارك والاجتماع في هذا المكان المبارك، لكم أنتم جميعا على سفركم وعنائكم ومشاركتكم وتفاعلكم. أشكر حقيقة جنود الخفاء من يعملون خلف الكواليس لجعل هذا اللقاء مباركا نافعا مفيدا. أشكر إخواني في لجنة التنظيم هنا وفي البحرين شخصا من الإخوة والأخوات. كذلك أشكر الإخوة المتطوعين الذين ساندونا من طلاب هذه الجامعة، من طلاب الجامعة الإسلامية المباركين الذين جزاهم الله خير، عملوا جهدا كبيرا للخروج بهذا اللقاء في أتمه. أشكر الرعاة جميعا على دعمهم لهذا اللقاء المبارك. حقيقة حتى أشكر من حضر معنا وتفاعل من خلف الفيافي القفار من خلال الحضور الإلكتروني معنا على البث المباشر، وهم كثر ولله الحمد، وقد نقلنا بعض أسئلتهم وتعليقاتهم في أثناء الجلسات. نعدكم بعون الله سبحانه وتعالى بأن نخرج هذه الجلسات بإذن الله مسجلة بالصوت والصورة، وبعض يعني إن شاء الله سنسعى إلى إخراج جلستي الرواد مكتوبة مطبوعة محررة بعون الله سبحانه وتعالى حتى يعم النفع بها، لأن فيها حقيقة تسجيل لذكريات وتسجيل حقيقة لنفائس وقضايا ربما لا توجد في بطون الكتب. فنسعى بعون الله سبحانه وتعالى إلى كتابة وتوثيق هذه التجربة الثرية بعون الله سبحانه وتعالى وتحريرها بالشكل اللائق حتى يعم النفع بها بعون الله سبحانه وتعالى. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، نستغفرك ونتوب إليك، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. لقاؤنا القادم إن شاء الله سبحانه وتعالى نرى هذه الوجوه الطيبة التي هي معنا هنا والتي معنا على البث المباشر، نراكم جميعا إن شاء الله يعني حسا وجسدا بعون الله في البحرين يومين 6 و7 نوفمبر. وبشركم بأن مؤتمرنا القادم يومين 6 و7 نوفمبر، عذرا على التاريخ الهجري أنا نسيته الآن، 6 و7 نوفمبر إن شاء الله في مملكة البحرين حرسنا الله، ستكون بإذن الله عز وجل بالشراكة مع شركائنا في النجاح للسنة العاشرة بحول الله، إخواننا في البنك الدولي وبالأخص الدكتور زميل الذي يقود مركز التمويل الإسلامي في البنك الدولي. نلتقيكم هناك إن شاء الله على خير، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.